The scientific study of how our solar system formed goes back more than two centuries, with many different models proposed to explain how our system of planets came to be. In the last few decades, we've been able to directly observe other solar systems in the process of formation, helping us refine models of how solar systems in general form. In this chapter, we'll start by reviewing the big trends observed in our own solar system and add a few more to the list. Then we'll discuss the current best model of how planets form. We'll have a look at the observations of solar systems forming today and tie them into the steps in the model. Finally, we'll have a look at the question of when our solar system formed, using the information from the decay of radioactive elements. Let's review the four big trends we discussed in the last chapter and add a few others that'll be relevant here. Remember that any model of the formation of the solar system should explain why these trends exist. First, we have the patterns of motion. Most objects orbit the sun in the same direction, and the planets are all very close to the same orbital plane. Next, we have two types of planets, small terrestrials and large Jovians, divided between the inner and outer solar systems. Third, we have the abundance of small bodies in the solar system. Finally, there are several planets that seem not to fit the patterns. In addition to these trends, there are three more observations that are worth keeping in mind as we discuss the formation of the solar system. The first of these is the one that we mentioned at the start of the term. Our sun is an ordinary star. There's nothing in the sun that suggests that the formation of our solar system should be an unusual event. The next observation is closely related to the previous one. Planets are common in our galaxy. A large fraction of all stars that have been studied closely have been found to have planetary systems orbiting them. Lastly, we have the observation that planets have a different composition than stars like the Sun. This is obviously true for the terrestrial planets, which have very little hydrogen and helium in them. But even the Jovian planets have a larger fraction of their mass in the form of heavy elements than the Sun does. Since the Sun's composition seems a lot more like the galaxy as a whole, we'll need to explain why the planets are so different. In the late 1700s, natural philosophers started developing models to explain how the solar system could have formed in a way consistent with Newton's laws of motion. One popular idea developed at that time was that the planets formed from a disk of matter orbiting around the sun. This idea was called the nebular hypothesis, or nebular model, and it was proposed by two of the biggest names in natural philosophy of the time, Immanuel Kant and Pierre-Simon de Laplace. This was just one of several models suggested over the next couple of centuries. However, by the late 1960s, it was given a much more rigorous mathematical footing by Viktor Safronov, and it became the dominant model of solar system formation. Since then, observations of other solar systems that are currently forming have confirmed large parts of the Safronov model, while suggesting a few important modifications. The steps in the formation of the solar system are the collapse to a disk, condensation and vaporization, solid body accretion, gas accretion and moon formation, and finally, cleanup and migration. As we discuss these steps in detail, you should keep in mind that they don't necessarily happen one after the other. There's considerable overlap in the timing, so that several of these are likely to be happening all at once. Before going through the steps in solar system formation, we should look at where it happens. The space between the stars is not completely empty. There's gas and dust scattered throughout space. We call this the interstellar medium. This interstellar medium is incredibly thin. The gas here is much less dense than the best laboratory vacuums, averaging only one atom per cubic centimeter. However, it's also clumpy. Some regions are much denser than others, and it's in these denser clouds that star formation occurs. One of the largest nearby big star-forming regions is in the constellation Orion. On the left, you can see a visible light picture of this part of the sky. On the right, you see the same region viewed in infrared light. The glow is caused by warm dust in this giant star factory. There are around a million stars forming in Orion right now. The force that starts the formation of a star, and hence a solar system, is gravity. Remember that gravity is a universal force. Every bit of matter pulls on every other bit of matter. In a cloud in the interstellar medium, this means that every bit of matter in the cloud pulls on all the rest, trying to draw all parts of the cloud closer together. One thing that tries to resist this is the cloud's temperature. The random motions of the atoms that give the gas its temperature also creates an outward pressure, preventing the cloud from collapsing in on itself. However, in the densest cores of these clouds, the density is high enough and the temperature is low enough that gravity can overcome this pressure and the collapse can begin. Once collapse starts, it tends to accelerate. As the parts of the cloud core get closer to each other, the gravitational pull between them gets stronger, so they fall towards each other more quickly. A cloud core can be up to a light year across. It will collapse down to a star that is 10 million times smaller. As it contracts, three things will happen to it. First, it will heat up. Remember that when something falls, it converts gravitational potential energy into kinetic energy. Since this gas is falling towards the center of the cloud, the same thing will happen here. However, the random motions of the gas atoms will turn that kinetic energy into heat. Second, the cloud will start spinning. This depends on the angular momentum of the original cloud. The angular momentum of the cloud depends on its mass, radius, and rate of spin. A large cloud core spins very slowly. However, as it contracts, the fact that its radius gets smaller means that it has to spin faster. This is similar to what happens when a figure skater starts to spin, then pulls in their arms, making them spin faster. So, as the cloud contracts, even a small initial spin gets amplified until some of the gas is going fast enough to go into orbit around the central mass. Third, the clumps of gas that orbit the center will start colliding with each other until they produce a flat disk shape. Once an average direction of motion is defined, any clouds that are orbiting at an angle to this will collide with the main disk until they line up with the rest. This is very similar to the process that keeps planetary rings on a flat plane. The end result of this collapse process is that most of the mass of the gas falls to the center to form a very hot, massive ball that we call a protostar. Surrounding this ball is a disk of gas orbiting around the protostar in the same direction that the protostar is spinning. In our own solar system, the protostar became the Sun, while the rest of the solar system formed from the disk of material orbiting it. The pattern we see now, with all planets and most smaller bodies orbiting in one direction, is a direct result of forming in a disk. If this were a stellar astronomy class, we would go on from here to focus mainly on the protostar and its evolution into a star like the Sun. However, in planetary astronomy, we're more interested in what happens in the disk instead. The next step in the formation of our solar system is the condensation and vaporization of solids. To understand this, we need to start by looking at what the disk is made of. At this point, there's no reason for the disk to be made of any different materials than the Sun. The Sun has most of the chemical elements represented in it, but most of these make up less than 0.1% of its mass. The list below shows the 10 most abundant elements in the Sun, along with how much of the Sun's mass they make up. Notice once again that hydrogen and helium completely dominate the mass. All of the other chemical elements combined are only 2% of the total. The most common elements in the solar system will tend to divide up into four major types of materials. Looking from right to left on this chart, we start with the most abundant material, the light gases. This is 98% of the mass of the disk, and it represents the overwhelming majority of the hydrogen and helium. Beside it is the hydrogen compounds, water, ammonia, and methane, or WAM for short. This is just under 1.5% of the disk, so it makes up most of the disk matter that isn't light gases. Next on the list is the rocks, or silicates. Rocks make up less than 0.5% of the disk. Finally, we have the metals, like iron and nickel. These come in at 0.2% of the disk. The other piece of information on this table is the condensation temperature. If you start with a very hot gas, these are the temperatures at which each of the materials condense out and form solids. Looking at it from the other direction, if you start with these as solids at extremely low temperatures and warm them up, they would start to vaporize into gases at the condensation temperatures. The thing to notice about this list is that the condensation temperatures divide up into three groups. The rocks and the metals have very high condensation temperatures. This means they will only be able to vaporize in places where it's extremely hot, very close to where the star is forming. Everywhere else, they'll be solids. The light gases have extremely low condensation temperatures, so low that they can't condense anywhere in the disk. They will always be gases. The hydrogen compounds have intermediate condensation temperatures, generally less than 150 Kelvin. This will do a lot to determine what kinds of planets form where.